Peace and love, y'all. It's your brother Avis, and we are here with another episode of What's the Word Wednesday, Season 2, Episode 18. And like we usually do, I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to throw in the topics for today in the comments. Also, I'm going to go ahead and let's put our show logo in the back. But with that, hope all is well with everyone that's out there. Shout out to those who are here, and shout out to those who will see this later, either on Instagram or on YouTube. If on YouTube, please like, share, comment, and subscribe to your boy for more to come. And as well as, let me know what's going on around you, how you feeling, and what is the word. And we got a cool show for y'all today. So, with the three topics that we have today for episode 18, we are going to be getting into speaking on about current events, seeing what's going on currently right now in the world and around. Then next, we're going to talk about love versus hate, break those down and speak on that. And lastly, we're going to go and we're going to speak on conquering doubts. And that one being a big one. But with those there, let's give time for more people to come in. As well as y'all let me know how I sound. If I sound good, everything's connected and we're doing fine. So let me know. It's the mind that you just growing and showing it never secular. Maybe in a second you searching for all the sections of right. Your whole life that you planned but never woke up. As well as, I forgot. It's so uncertain, but don't be scared. It's enough for you to feel. Gotta bring in the noises. I'm gonna get used to that, y'all. I'm gonna get used to it. Alright, let me. No type of stance. But it's funny how we making it seem like it's a trance. Alright, really, I think we good. For sure. In the stance that you taking. Yeah, one more minute. Never fake it. Go ahead and then we gonna continue. We gonna continue and start with the show. But if y'all have anything that you want to share, anything, thoughts, minds, perspective, please throw them in the comments. As well as when we get to the section of the show, if you want to chime in, please chime in and make known what you want to speak on, as well as on the topics too. So love, appreciation, I love the participation, as well as I appreciate your time. So we are here, y'all. All right, let's let this finish off. We're going to get into the show song, and we're going to start off, of course, with these current events. All right, y'all. Let's go. Show song, and let's get it going. If you learn to sing along, if not, just listen in. And people always be asking, what's going on? So we tell them like this. What's the word, y'all? What's the word? What's the word, y'all? What's the word? What's the word, y'all? What's the word? You tell them like, what's the word? What's the word? What you heard? We gotta know, yeah, what's the word? Once again, y'all, peace and love. It's your brother Atvis, and we are here with another episode of What's the Word Wednesday, Season 2, Episode 18. So as y'all are coming in, again, let me know how y'all feeling, how are you doing, and what's the word? As well as shout out to those who are going to be watching now or even later here on Instagram or on YouTube. If so, like, comment, share, subscribe to your boy for more content to come. But with that, y'all, for today's episode, again, we're getting into current events as a topic. We're going to speak on the topic of love versus hate. And lastly, we're going to speak on the topic of conquering doubts.
But with that, let's get to the first topic, these current events. So, currently, what I got for news today, y'all, is surrounded around health, U.S., as well as finance, more so as in changes in finances and things. What's going on? Peace and love. Peace and love. So I'm just getting into the current events, y'all. So appreciate y'all coming in. So we're going to be speaking on current events, whether it's talking about right now, I'm going to be getting into health. I'm going to be getting into what's going on a little bit in the U.S. And then lastly, something about finances in here. What's going on, Brother Lyrics? Brother Kundan in the building, as well as those who are here. Appreciate y'all. All right. So, first headline that we got. What's the word, famo? First headline that we got from an article. This is from NPR. And again, we're speaking on health, so this is the health things. So, this is pertaining to coronavirus again in a pandemic. So, article reads, the pandemic led to the biggest drop in U.S. life expectancy since World War II, study finds. So again, this is from NPR, and there's a study that shows that the pandemic has dropped the life expectancy in the U.S. since World War II. So I'm going to speak on a little bit of it. Once again, always two paragraphs and we out. If y'all have anything, please drop it in the comments and we will get to it also. But all right. So, article reads, a new study estimates that life expectancy in the U.S. decreased by nearly 2 years between 2018 and 2020, largely due to COVID-19 pandemic. And the declines were most pronounced among minority groups, including Black and Hispanic people. This is part of that, the first part there. So y'all tell me how y'all feeling about that. On top of that, it says, in 2018, average life expectancy in the U.S. was about 79 years, which roughly was 78.7. It declined to about 77 years by the end of 2020, according to a new study that was published in the British Medical Journal. I'm gonna read the last part and then we're out. We have not yet seen a decrease like this since World War II. It is a horrific disease in life expectancy, decrease in life expectancy, said Stephen Wolf of the Virginia Commonwealth University School of Medicine and an author of a study released on Wednesday. So there's more to be said and put here with that, but just know that during this 2 year between 2018-2020, it has shown that life expectancy has dropped by 2 years. So it's interesting. I wanted to share that since we're still in the midst of this, or the midst of this. But that's the first thing. Let me see, because I already saw right here. I want to see. So Kundan had put, I was just reading about Britney Spears getting forced to get a IUD by her conservator, something that happens in indigenous women often. Interesting. I saw some of those headlines, but I didn't read any more into that. So if you know a little bit more, please, Kundan, come in a bit and share that with everyone. So I appreciate it. Thank you. And again, life expectancy. It's very interesting. All right. Going again, some more health. This one comes from CNN Health. And the article title reads, scientists says early coronavirus samples were deleted from NIH database. So I spoke last time and a previous time about the government and the U.S., the Biden administration, were doing a investigation into the origins of where the virus came from. Some say the out of the lab theory is just a theory, it's not a thing, but now we have some things about how some samples were deleted from the database. Let's see what this article has entail. Right. Article reads, scientists investigating the origins of the coronavirus pandemic might be working with the wrong samples because some early samples of the virus submitted by a Chinese researcher were deleted from a shared database, an expert in the evolution of viruses says. Jesse Bloom, a researcher at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Center in Seattle, said he found genetic sequences taken from early coronavirus cases in China that were deleted from a U.S. National Institute of Health database. Examination shows some of the early cases in the Chinese city of Wuhan are different genetically from the variants that eventually spread to cause the pandemic. The sequence themselves do not shed any more light on the renewed debate about whether the virus spread naturally from animals to humans or was the result of a laboratory leak that Bloom told CNN. But he says his analysis shows the samples being used to investigate the origins of the COVID-19 pandemic may not be complete, which, interesting. So, from Jesse Bloom, he's given more details to say that there was early samples that were deleted from the database. And figuring out that we didn't have the original samples to even be working with to figure it out. And that this was a different variant from the virus that would come to affect everything, which is very intriguing to know. Again, deleting some disappear, so... Wonderful, y'all. Always something going on with this. But yeah, Institute of Health. But let me see what else y'all got in here. Said I was just learning about a friend died from a few weeks ago. Another night from died a few months ago. Sending out condolences to you and to the families. Heartache and losing self and losing sense of, you know, direction and people in this life can definitely be heavy. So send condolences. But thank you for sharing that. But yeah, with this, more on outbreaks. And right now, there are a few outbreaks that are going on in, if I'm correct, still in India. We have Russia. Now this outbreak is going in Afghanistan when it comes to the virus. But this article I'm going to read to you has a little twist. Not a twist, but more so a concern that has been brought up. But here it is. Article comes from Deseret News, if I'm saying that right. And the title reads, despite rising outbreaks, even Russian doctors don't want Russia's vaccine. Interesting. Article reads, after a year of moderately managed outbreaks, Russia is currently experiencing some of its worst COVID-19 outbreaks, reports Newsweek. A general hesitancy towards vaccination, the new, more infectious Delta virus, which is another one we spoke on last time, and delayed restrictions have contributed to rising cases, says the New York Times. And two bullet points they put, out of Russia's population of 144 million people, only 18 million people have gotten at least one of the doses. And this is reported by Al Jazeera, if I'm saying it right, maybe saying it wrong. Don't get me. Second point, Tuesday, Russia recorded 16,715 new cases, twice as many as last month, says Newsweek. And there's more putting it about how bad the outbreaks are. But I wanted to read at least a little bit here on why doctors, at least Russian doctors, are hesitant. And this is what we have here. So, last August, Russia approved a domestic-made COVID-19 vaccine for widespread use, the Sputnik vaccine. Now, the country has approved four different Russian-made vaccines, reports Al Jazeera. No foreign-made vaccines are available in the country, but Russian-made vaccines are widely available. Now, when it comes to that, and I'm going to speak in on the next part on this and what Sputnik is, but the Russian government says the Sputnik vaccine is more than 90% effective, but the Russian public have remained distrustful of the government's vaccination approval. So, there's a lot of the doctors waiting to want to see the effectiveness of this. And it says about 50 of the Russian doctors want further evidence of effectiveness of the Sputnik vaccine. And about 30% of the doctors have refused the vaccine because of these doubts. So right now, there's just the doubts. And from the doctors, now that's into the public, from these homemade vaccines within Russia, because they cannot get any from outside. So there's a lot of doubts and speculation between taking this Sputnik one. So just wanted to add that in there. On the topic of figuring out what Sputnik is, that particular vaccine, there's another article, and this is by The Guardian, and it reads, "WHO, the World Health Organization, voices concerns over Sputnik V COVID vaccine plant." So, interesting. Now, let's see what is in detail. So here we go. It reads, The World Health Organization has said it has concerns about the methods used at one plant producing the Sputnik V vaccine, as Slavica announced it would sell or donate 160,000 of the 200,000 doses it has ordered for the Russian shot. The WHO, which along with the European Medicines Agency, the EMA, is reviewing Sputnik V for eventual approval. So again, might be the whole thing with the emergency use authorization, but it's not been approved. Said in a report on Wednesday, it had issues with the integrity of quality control data and test results at one of the four production sites it has seen. The WHO review also identified concerns with cross-contamination and sterility, as well as with tracing and identifying batches of vaccines at the pharma standard UF Vita plant in Bashkortostan, terrible, Russia, which fills vials with vaccine made elsewhere. So, there's just a lot of, again, concerns, ethical concerns, as well as safety and sanitary concerns with the Sputnik V COVID vaccine, especially particular plants that's there in Russia. So it gives to the point of why there's more skepticism and not, you know, people wanting to take it, especially the doctors, you know. So, or pushback, I should say. But that's what's going on with Sputnik V. Now, Still finishing Owen Health. We got a few more, and then after that, we'll keep commencing with the rest of the show. But once again, if y'all have anything that you want to add, please throw them in the comments and let me know, because this is just not only me, but this is all of us informing each other of what's going on around us, because I can't get to all the news. But if you can, appreciate it very much. It's all here. Right. Next thing. This article from Entrepreneur. Title reads, this symptom of COVID-19 is more frequent in vaccinated people, according to study. So, we'll see. I don't know the particular name of the study, but it says one study, which I can click on it and we'll see what that study is. But, article reads, we all know that sneezing can be a symptom of any cold or even common cold if you suffer from an allergy. However, one study suggests that excessive sneezing can also be a symptom of COVID-19 in people who have been vaccinated. So, I'm going to look at the study at least to give you the name of it. See, it's interesting. So, what is the name of this study? Which is very interesting. There's a lot going on with it. So, it looks like it's a study that has to go with this app that is called the ZoCOVID Study app. I don't know any more around it. I'm looking. But just know that there's a study out there that they're doing through this ZoCOVID Study app that breaks down why this excessive sneezing is a symptom in those who've been vaccinated. It's right here. I'll read it. Research conducted by the Zoe Company and King's College London explains that although many people who contract SARS-CoV-2, which is the proper name for it, can sneeze, it is not a definitive symptom of the disease. However, it has been found that it can become a common sign in people who have already received the injection against the virus. So, it's saying it's not necessarily it, but they're seeing some of the commonalities. It's a possibility. So, I'm not going to read any more into that, but just letting y'all know, this is something, again, from the Entrepreneur, and it's saying that the symptom of excessive sneezing is more frequent in those who have gotten the shot. So, just updating. Now, again, I just wanted to bring this back up for those who did not know or not sure what is going on, but there's another variant we have out there. It's called the Delta variant, and what is it starting to show that it is having more of an effect on those who have not yet received the shot. And this is from NBC News, and the title reads, coronavirus variant spreading rapidly among unvaccinated. Short of it just says, health officials are warning a rapid spreading COVID-19 variant is causing a spike in cases among young people and in communities of color. Once again, reading the fine lines of what's being said. Last month, the Delta variant, which was first detected in India, accounted for just over 2% of cases in the U.S., and now that number is up to 20%. Dr. Jerry Abraham, vaccine director of Kindred City Health Centers in Los Angeles, spoke with CBNSC's Tanya Rivero about the spike in cases. So, there's a video there, but it's a long video. I'm not going to play it for y'all, but just know this again. Now, this variant, the Delta variant, went from 2% in the U.S. to now 20%, which it originated from India. But just keep that in mind. Genoa's out there. Y'all do your precautions like you usually do. If you have been gotten the shot, wonderful. If you haven't, continue to do those precautions to keep yourself healthy, safe, whatever that you need to end up doing to feel protected, whatever you need. Right. Last things having to do with the U.S. and the finance. So, next thing, article from NPR, and this is in politics, but I still say within U.S. politics. The article reads, "It's an outrage. Biden outlines new steps to curb surging gun violence." And we know, or we've seen, there's been many shows of misuse of guns, going to protest and shooting, going to open places and just committing crimes and violence against other people with guns. So Biden is taking a step to look into this to stop the dealing of guns from other people's, as well as to address these spikes. So, article reads, again, two paragraphs and we out. With cities across the country witnessing spikes in violent crimes, the White House on Wednesday announced a new plan to tackle gun violence, building on President Biden's vow to make it his priority to curb America's gun violence epidemic. Citing the uptick in violence since the coronavirus pandemic forced millions of Americans out of work and into their homes for extended periods, Biden on Wednesday announced a 5-point proposal that includes these 5 points. What's going on, Brother Fred Wizard in the building with the words? What's the word, my G? All right, here's the 5 points plan or proposal. First one is cracking down on gun sellers who violate federal laws with a new zero tolerance policy. So we have another of those policies coming in. And we got the sister officially frosty in the building, the coldest in the room. We got the wizard and we got the coldest in the room with us. Right. So first one again, they're cracking down on gun sellers who are basically breaking laws. The second point is giving additional support to local law enforcement to help with summer crime increases. Because it seems as crimes continue during the summer, you see things increases. I don't know, people get high, all these other different things. I know there's data on that. I can't give you all of that, but there's some in there. We got the brother MC Zero in the building, N-Zero Clan. All y'all coming through. Appreciate y'all. Peace and love. What's the word to y'all? All right. Third point. Investing in community violence intervention programs. So, making sure that there's programs for people stop with the violence. Four, expanding summer employment and services, particularly for teens and young adults, to help stop with this. And then lastly, the other point is helping formerly incarcerated individuals successfully re-enter their communities. So that is another interesting thing. We got y'all coming in here. What's going on, my brother? Brother John in the building does his thing, as well as the brother Prince. Good to see y'all. What's the word? But basically, with this, he has this 5-point proposal to help stop with gun violence. There's more of that, y'all, but I'm going to stop here with it. Continue off is in NPR again. But if y'all have any more, please throw it in the comments. I got one last news, and we're going to get into these topics. All right, or at least the next topic. So, lastly, I thought this was interesting because it caught my eye. And this, again, having to do with more so finance business. But this is from CNN Business. And article title reads, Warren Buffett resigns from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Now, you're probably wondering, okay, like, why is this a big thing? For those who do know or don't know, that Warren Buffett is one of these huge, big investing billionaires that has so much money and power when it comes to being on top of other different businesses and companies, being the CEO of his own. Like, there's a lot of power in this man when it comes to money. So for him to be resigning from also the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, it's something you want to keep an eye on. You know, at least me personally, keep an eye on. Follow the money. But article reads, Warren Buffett has resigned from his trustee position at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. The 90-year-old investor announced Wednesday. Dude, this dude is 90 years old, bruh. Golly. In a statement, Buffett didn't specifically say why he is leaving the foundation, but he noted that he has already resigned from all corporate boards other than Berkshire Hathaway. Buffett added that the foundation's new CEO, Mark Zuzman, is an outstanding selection and has his full support. So, this is the part I'm going to read these last two, and then we out. Buffett and Bill Gates are close friends. His announcement comes out about a month after Bill and Melinda Gates also announced their divorce and some and other subsequent reports about Gates' improper behavior with Microsoft employees decades ago. So we just got a lot of stuff just building back up from what this is going on with. And for those who don't know on what the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is, I'll read this paragraph, let y'all know, and then we are going to be done with the news for today unless y'all got more. But here it is. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation was created in 2000. So after this Y2K. And it is funded by the couple's personal wealth as well as several other Gates family foundations and a gift pledged by Buffett. Since 2000, the foundation has spent nearly $54 billion on a wide range of initiatives related to global health, poverty alleviation, and more recently, the global rollout of the COVID-19 vaccines, according to its website. So, just know, been since 2000, Bill and Melinda doing these things. And to also remind y'all too that Bill Gates did not go to college. If I'm correct, he was also a high school dropout. And this man has been getting money, putting it into different places for other different things. So be mindful and watchful of where the money's going. So that's why I find it that this is something to think about. Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, all of these things that are going on right now. So stay tuned in. But other than that, y'all, that is all the news that I got for y'all today. If y'all have any more, please throw them in the comments. I appreciate y'all's time. I appreciate y'all's participation and your thoughts. But with that, y'all, we're going to get into the next topic, which everyone is invited to come on and talk. We can actually have three people on at a time, so that could be four of us on the screen. But the next topic that we're going to get into is the topic of love versus hate. Those words are used so much. Love versus hate. Okay? Now, if y'all want to write, y'all want to come in, just request. More than welcome to. If not, I'm going to just lay down a foundation for we looking at love and hate. But as I am doing that, and I'm going to give definitions, y'all let me know. When you hear the word, we're going to start with love. When you hear the word love, what is the first thing that comes to mind, phrase or word? Yo, yo, yo. What's good, brother? What's the word?
Love.
Let's give it in. Let's see. We got to welcome. This is the brother, Fred Wizard, to the place.
Hey, what?
Yeah, I had to do it on you, man. Yeah, y'all. Yeah. But what's good with you, brother?
It's right here, man.
Mm. So what you got for me, man? I'm going to lay down these definitions, but if you want to tap into the whole thing on love versus hate, like,
yeah,
you should let me know.
I love love.
You love love. Yes. Yes, I got the sound effects. I have to. I'm working on them. I got them. You know, I got. Yeah. Got to get a little John. Got to get all of that in here. Right. Love, love, hate, hate. We'll see what's going on with it. All right, I'm going to lay down these definitions, y'all, and then we're going to get into it. So, according to Webster's Dictionary, because Webster's, for some reason, is just a different name. So, definitions it has for love, which is a lot of them. It says, first one, strong affection for another arising out of kinship or personal ties. That's the first one they have for love. Second one, attraction based on sexual desire, love. Third one, affection based on admiration. It's another one. Another one, an assurance of affection given. Assurance of affection given. Third one, warm attachment, enthusiasm, or devotion. There's so many. I can keep going, y'all. I'll give two more, but there's so many of them, which is interesting. Another one they have, the fifth definition says, a god or the personification of love. Interesting. I'm going to use the word to define itself, but okay. The last one, a score in tennis. That makes sense. Love, love is a score of zero. Yes. And then also brotherly concerns for others. So there's so many different ones because we can talk about the various different types of love. You have the aguape love. You have the eros love. All those other types of love. But I just want to break down just the definitions that they had here. And I mean, I have others, but we're going to just stop it for right there, brother. Now, you let me know. What do you think of when you hear the word love, bro? But you gotta let somebody
Didn't he change his name to love? Hold on, man.
For real? Keep it
going. I appreciate that. That's yeah, he didn't change his name to love.
Interesting. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I didn't even know that.
He put to the picture of his ID. His new ID says love.
He then went through like so many different name changes at this point that I'm like, whatever.
But check it out. Check out where he's probably at right now. He's probably just like loving. Probably just loving everybody around him, bro.
Possibly. I don't know. I don't know his life like that.
I know. I'm telling you. Kanye says, I want my grandchildren to be floating.
He wants his grandchildren to be floating?
Yeah, but like I'm so much love. You know, like, think about that for a second. Like, for me, that's what like love is. You know, like, it comes from all many directions. It comes from people, things, just the world, bro. Like, love is coming from everywhere, but it's a love that you personally soak up that, like, helped you grow. You know what I mean? I was just talking about that earlier. Talk about growing, you know?
No, that's very true.
You know what I mean? Like, people change. People change through love. You know what I mean? And people change through fear, you know? The fear of... I don't want to be. I don't want to be just like a nobody. You know, I want to make a change in the world. So, out of love, the change you make it, or out of fear that you don't make it. You know, it's weird, but like it's like this polarity with like things that are done through love and through fear. You know, how much things are doing through love, and how much things are doing through fear.
Yeah.
Things that you can survive off fear, but yeah, you're gonna be fearful. You want to change that shit to love. Like, I'm not trying to blow up or come up because I'm scared that anything to happen for me. It's more like I know that it will, you know?
Yeah.
What's that love, right?
Interesting, brother.
How you been?
Yep.
You good?
But as you doing that, yeah, I see you. Yes, yes, Kundan, yes. Like a, yes, like a Guape, Storic, Eros, Platonic, yes. All of those that are there. There's eight different types, but like I said, we're not going to get so specific and try to break down every single one of them. It's really, that's why I really want to get down to at least the nitty gritty when asking people, because once again, like a lot of these words and a lot of these definitions that we have for them, there is no universal one.
Yeah.
There's not one love. You see love a different way than I do see love versus another person sees love and doing that. Most of the people can say that it's something they see, but some people say it's something they feel in the senses. There's a number of different ways people describe how love is, just like Fred Words just said right now, the Wizard just said, like, literally people using it either to coddle that fear or just to the love of the fact to improve and grow. Like, there's a number of ways to come with that. But when you think about love, let's think about what are the
people,
pros,
huh? Some people love meat, some people love grass.
It's a number of things. Now, with not having to do any, and in that particular case, what are the pros and what are some of the cons to love or loving things?
Oh, there's a lot. Come in.
What you got?
So sometimes we think we love things.
Mm.
You know what I mean? You know, it's like, sometimes it's like, you ever like, I want it, but don't need it. I need it, but don't want it.
Mm.
You know, so imagine throwing love in there. You know, sometimes you love things that are hurting you, you know?
Yes.
So you kind of, you like, think you love it. You know, you make sacrifices with love. You know?
Gotcha.
And then you're either talking about people or talking about things, you know? Like, you know, for the love of music, what do you sacrifice for? You know, it's like action, right? You never, like, show it.
Yeah.
Love is an action.
Yes. I'm definitely with you on that one. So, but again, y'all, I can't see you right now, Kundan, but y'all, welcome. We got Kundan that's here with us now, too.
I'm in bed because I'm tired, so I'm just that's why my lights are off too.
Okay. No. So, oh, you're all good. You're all good. But how are you doing? Yeah. What's the word? What you got?
What's the word? It's good. It's funny because I just came off a book study group on clarity and connection, which is the name of the book we were studying, and we did talk about love a little bit. So yeah, it's kind of cool.
Now, appreciate you definitely sharing that. Now, like I had asked the Wizard, now, what are some pros and cons to love or loving things?
Yeah, I'm glad, you know, you started with the definitions, right?
Yeah.
I feel like, just like the word peace, love is one of those things that it's a word that is used to manipulate people into doing things that they don't want to do, right?
Mm.
Like, especially people who are abusers,
who
will abuse you, and then if you call them out on it, they'd be like, oh, you're not a loving person, you don't love me, or you're a hateful person, when you're just calling them out. It's not, you know, you're not being hateful, right? So, yeah, in reality, calling them out is the loving thing to do in that case, right?
So I hear you on that. So I might ask to both of y'all too, is love a physical thing? Is it a mental thing? Is it a spiritual thing? or is it emotional and a feeling that you get?
Of course.
Is a combination of all those?
All of them.
It makes sense. It makes sense. The reason why I'm saying that is I'm literally trying to get at least a basis of, if we're speaking on love, you know,
I how think many it points? Is all four, mm-hmm. but it has to be expressed in an impact. That impact always trumps intention. So I would emphasize the action more than the other three.
Okay.
Because otherwise people will always cop out behind, I didn't intend to harm you, but you did actually harm me, you know. So again, it's used to manipulate people. So I always emphasize the action and the impact over everything else. And that's why even my love language has changed. It used to be like touch and words.
Yeah.
But I realized words can be easily manipulated. Mm-hmm. So now my love language has become service. Like, you show love by actually doing it. Actually, you know, being loving towards me.
I definitely feel that, because I agree that it definitely does do with the impact and the action part when it comes to love. For me, I was more so stuck in a lot of, not to say stuck, but was programmed into the concept of love being from this Disney type movies and things and stuff of that nature.
Yeah.
So a lot of the basis of when you were thinking of love, you know, all of the love and things of like what your concepts and stuff is love as a child definitely can be brought on from the TV. And what it ends up doing, is that it starts giving you a false sense of what love truly is. So that's why people start wandering around trying to figure out what is love to them, what is this. And that's where you can get the manipulation happening. So you can get people using it for fear, whatever it is, because of the fact that from what you've been seeing on the programs of TV, it told you this is what true love or what this type of love is, when in fact that there's multiple ways to show it, and that everybody loves differently, and that not one love is the same as another type of love. And for me, y'all know me, I love acronyms. So I made an acronym for love that for me embodies that action part that has to do with doing with love, which
I love that.
My acronym for love is learning others' values every day. So literally, and you can look at, you can substitute that O with learning one's values, learning our values, learning others' values every day. So the thing is, the action in learning somebody else, learning yourself, and learning a person that you're with, that is your form of love. So whatever that may be doing, you're learning more about what this person does. Maybe you're learning about more so what you two do together, create this sense of that. And I think giving that action, as well as giving somebody your time, and you're once again, like you said, I saw another person in here was talking about, oh yeah, Frosty was saying sacrificing. That's really all of those points in there for me, to that shows and exemplifies what love is. Since we can have all these,
I love
multitudes.
That. It reminds me of the saying that
I love hip hop.
Love is not two people looking into each other's eyes. It's two people looking in the same direction.
That's a good one. What?
Yeah.
Kundan comes with all of these sayings. I mean, on the real.
Hey, Kundan, you throwing the kickback?
Of course. Yeah. This fool came in here. I love hot moms. Of course, your shirt. I remember.
You love.
You throwing a party, huh?
KZ, you are so extra, my G. You can ask me that later, not now.
Stacey's
okay?
Mom.
Oh, my
God. What's got it going on?
So good.
Stacey, can't you see? You're not the girl for me.
So,
Stacey's mom. What's got it going on?
So goofy. Oh, my goodness. But look, we're going to continue still more with this because I want more into it. But I wanna add another point. This is a poem from a brother that I've gotten to meet, at least over the Instagrams, and he goes by the name of Artist FMC. He has a book called The Life of Poetry. And he has a point in here about what's love to him. And I wanted to read it so we can also add more to this convo about it. So,
what's love got to do with it?
In his book, he says,
what's love got to do with it?
What's love? Huh? Yeah, babe, bruh. It's literally all of that, bro.
Everything.
So, he says, what's love to you? Just the things I do? Can we have a conversation without complications? I listen to you with patience. I don't like when you get mad about something we haven't created. I just want to cling to your soul like a baby, but I know life is hectic. I won't look down upon myself because the experiences or choices I made, they want me to frown up upon myself. So that's love. Oh, you want me to be on top of me, yourself? You don't want me to breathe? You don't want me to leave until I cheat? Love, you are so confusing to yourself. So I will leave you with the same question. What's love? Hey, the brother be spitting. So, like you were saying, what's love got to do with it? And when you express that love to someone, or you give that love and that energy to someone, and it is seen in that contradicting way, not on the other side of hate, but it's not received the way that is received, then it's seen as an attack. So then what do you want me to do then? Do you want me to love? Do you want me to do? Where am I going with this? I just want to give this energy, learn this from you, and give this back to you. So that is another way when it comes to at least the misinterpretation when it comes to love, like he was saying with these different languages and stuff too. We got in here, it says, love is putting the pride to the side. So, to add on top of that before we get into the hate part, I didn't get to hear a bit, but the cons of really loving someone are the word love. Few that I can think of is the whole idea of balancing love. Because when you are overly in love with someone or something, you don't take the necessary steps to support or identify the issues and problems that are surfacing. You decide to avoid and to move away from what is being seen. And I see you got something, brother, so go ahead.
There's two sides. So right, I think we're talking about this shit, right? There's two sides to the story, then there's the truth, right?
Yep.
Come in. Check this out. So I think that that form of love is the one they refer to as being blind. Like you think you love them, right? And then there's like real love, where it's like just real love, you know. When you know you love them. And then when you talk about love, it's like a miracle, you know. It's like love is just, it keeps going back and forth, right? That's the love that rolls through, you know. But Psycho Rose does it best, I think. He has a song called Love Letters. They have it. I'm not sure that one yet. This is Rose. Keep going. He says, he's like, you know what a love letter is? He's like, it's a bullet from a gun. You get a love letter from me, you're forever. So that is that like way of like thinking like fuck love, you know, love will get you killed, right? But if you know, I think it's like if you really love it, you don't give a fuck. You'll live for it and die for it if you truly love it.
Yeah, I feel like sometimes also when what we think is love, it's actually just infatuation or attachment or craving,
desire,
or even possessiveness.
Yeah, love is a drug.
You know, or jealousy, right? And I think that's why love has to be balanced with truth, clarity, and justice. Right?
Mm-hmm.
One of my my favorite stories is it's a comparison between the person who wrote and sang the song, you know, "All You Need Is Love," right?
Mm.
John Lennon, right?
Mm.
And then the person who wrote and sang the song "Love Is Not Enough," who, by the way, is also the front man for the band Rage Against the Machine, right?
Yeah.
So guess who was actually abusive to his wife and his gay Jewish manager? John Lennon, who wrote "All You Need Is Love." So he didn't have a realistic idea of love, which is why in his real life,
yeah,
he was actually a very abusive man. Whereas the person who had a realistic idea of love, who even wrote the song, "Love Is Not Enough," and in fact, you know, whereas John Lennon's, you know, performances were often fluffy, like the guy not only wrote the song "Love Is Not Enough,"
yeah,
he had a band literally called Rage Against the Machine,
yeah,
and his performances looked very violent on stage, mm, right? Because he was able to access that part of himself in his art,
yeah,
so that in his real life, he was actually a loving person. Because he had an outlet for that part of him that was full of rage.
Mm. Which now you're tapping into that other side, which I do wanna move over into it, but I got one more thing I wanna add on top about love.
We should make a love detector test.
Now that will be very difficult because of the fact is, where are you going to be able to really detect where love is coming from? So I'm saying from the mind, from the heart, from the soul.
From the dick.
Yo, bruh.
From the penis.
From, you know, from all those different regions. So that's why really it's hard to pinpoint specifically what love is. But the whole idea of at least the action behind it and the feeling and what you're putting out and giving to someone, you say the acts of love.
How do you measure love?
So, man, I brought you 10 presents. That's how much I love you. You've only brought me 2.
Ooh.
You know, but see, but look it. That's where that becomes the whole thing of an exchange type of relationship, mm-hmm, and that type of love. So
you, yeah?
It's only that it's very hard to put all of that into terms. That's why it's very subjective, while at the same time it's very objective, because of the fact that we are not always going to be able to fully understand and know truly what the intention of the universal love is. You get that
at the same
feeling.
Time I think like some level of reciprocity is important. Like, if you're always the one trying to make plans with your friend and your friend doesn't return, you know, any, like, you know, the favor, or doesn't try to make plans sometimes,
yeah,
then like something is off. Maybe it might be time to move on, you know.
Oh yeah, that's where, yeah, learning others, yeah, values every day. You start learning your,
right,
relationships,
yeah,
and the people that you're in. You're constantly vetting and you're getting to know who you're in a relationship with, whatever you're building. Because at the end of the day, we do change. We continue to grow. Not saying that you're going to grow completely different. You'll still be at the core of what you have as a person. But then your tastes change. Your ideals change. Your beliefs can change. And if you fell in love, or you were in love with that person for a particular thing, and now they don't love the same thing that you love, that can cause friction and a misunderstanding if it is not addressed. But
yeah,
ultimately, I mean, with love, because I'm getting to the hate now, y'all say it's definitely one of the biggest drugs for sure. But just really figuring out what is your concept and what do you think love embodies. Once you're able to pinpoint that for yourself, then you're able to have a clearer view of what you can witness and think love is, and then you can tap into other people to see what they feel love is. Now, on that opposite side, it's relative. On the opposite side, that reciprocity, the whole thing there that you were saying, the duality, but there's more than just a duality, but we're speaking on it. Now was the other side when it comes to hate. Now, y'all, What do y'all think of when you hear the word hate? What is the first few things that come into your mind when you hear the word hate?
I think more of like hate crimes or racist hate crimes, people killing each other, or you know, even like pushing each other, right? Like some of the like police brutality or even the anti-Asian hate crimes when they were pushing older men, right?
Mm-hmm.
When people hate somebody so much that they respond to physical violence, or even verbal violence, right? Like using the N-word against somebody, right?
Mm-hmm.
Things like that would be hate, right?
Feel that. Wizard, you got some?
I hate hate.
All right. We'll start this off. I appreciate it. I'm going to start this off. I'm an acronym dude. I came up with it today, too. Y'all can let me know how you feel about it. But what I'm starting to notice on both of these sides, it definitely has to pinpoint on the action. Now, an acronym that I have for hate, and I said, like I did today, I have is called Holding Anguish Threatening Everyone. So when you're hate, you're holding anguish, some type of you feeling or whatever it may be. And when you put that out, you're threatening everyone.
Bro, you gotta chill.
I gotta
physical action.
You're going in hard, bro. Damn.
I'm just saying. I just have to, like, I'm setting it up because.
You know what? That's holding, right? The fact that you can hold it,
mm-hmm.
it's a personal thing, you know? So it's like you can hate everything, but none of that gets affected, right?
Mm.
You're the one who gets affected because you're the hater, right? You're the one holding, living on with that. You're dealing with it. It's in you. No, they say that hate is like freaking poison, but expecting the person to die. Kind of like
that. Yeah. The reason why it came to it is because ultimately on both of those sides, who is the one that's experiencing either love or hate? That's you. And you can give that out to somebody because you're not going to know necessarily. I'm not going to know necessarily if Kundan is experiencing love right now or experiencing hate, but I know how I may be experiencing either one of those there. And that's why.
What am I experiencing?
We're getting it right now. Oh, this dude. Now, you're experiencing life right now. That's what you're doing. But ultimately, where does hate originate? Where's the root?
Yeah, it's crazy because, like, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one. Because if you think of, like, evolutionary-wise, like, you know, you made a fire, you brought food to your tribe, like, you feel love, right? You went to your people, like,
West Coast Ninja.
You feel love. Mm. What happens for them for you to feel hate at a time like that, right? To the enemy, right? To somebody who conquered. Yeah, exactly. That's where it comes from. Exactly.
Experiences?
It comes from the fucking gentrifiers. Bam.
Yeah.
Hate these motherfuckers.
Yeah, I think part of it is ignorance and the false narratives or stories we're told, or some people are told.
Christopher Columbus.
It's also just, Yeah, that's a great example.
It goes from that motherfucker.
That's the second example I want to say. Like, part of it is just straight up greed and power, right? Greed, like when you just want to completely dominate somebody, you kind of whip up hate against this person first inside yourself in order to justify and overcome your own conscience so that you don't have to feel guilty about killing somebody and take their land. And then you use that same hate programming and narrative to whip up hate in other people so that they follow you in demonizing and destroying this group of people from whom you're taking their land and resources and and even their, you know, their autonomy, right? Like in the case of, you know, the Europeans enslaving Africans, right? When they not only took away their land and their religion and everything, they took away even their bodily autonomy, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I agree to definitely to both of y'all's points for sure. I definitely want to say the initial of where hate originates from and the root cause for a lot of this stuff is starting with self and the experiences that you have with self. And then that comes out into experiences around you. So I'm not saying, of course, we're not born with being hateful or born and loving this particular case, but it comes to a certain feeling and frequency, not from just only the outside, but from the inside, that once again, you tap into this and now you're in a place of seeing a lot of different things. Just like, I hate that, I hate this, or I love this, I love that. So again, when I speak about us being more than just this body, we're souls, we're energy, frequency, and vibration, having experience, that's where a lot of these things start from. So if you fluctuate and you stay in that certain vibe, that's why I say good vibes only or no negative, all these other different places, we associate it with it being on a particular frequency. So I see it more so the root is coming from within, and then it is being either expanded or is being exacerbated by outside experiences, as well as that's where you start getting to hold things with different emotions of anger, envy, fear, all these other different things that code in together to start creating, holding anguish and threatening everyone because of the fact that you're trying to make sense of why you're not in a better state that you are, and you see someone else that's in a greater state than you are. Now you're basically projecting those feelings over into them to hopefully think you can feel better. Because I'm gonna tell y'all now, the reason why I know for sure that this love and hate thing definitely too is different types of energies is because, I don't know, if any of y'all ever been in a confrontation or a heated discussion, and if you've kept your cool and the other person is just yelling mad and just extremely off of the top, and you're just there holding your composure, you're cool and you're calm, you start to notice that literally that person also starts to come down to where you're at too. Because what ends up happening is when you have that type of energy, you're trying to get it out. So if somebody is reflecting back with you that energy, that person is being able to get rid of that hate. So now they pass it on to you. It's almost like hot potato, at least from what I'm seeing it. And when you hold on to it for so long, it just becomes your reality. And the thing is, now how do you get yourself out of that? Well, there's a number of ways for you to do that. One of the main ways to be able to get that out of you is, honestly, we say it all the time, it really is being aware that you are feeling this type of way. And when you're feeling this type of way, knowing the people or the resources or things that you can tap into to help you to show it in an appropriate or at least in a better fashion to get it out. Because what happens is we hold that in, again, like if it's a bottle or a thermostat, and the more we hold in this, it's going to go overboard to the point where it's almost going to be no return. So when you were speaking about, you know, what you were saying with him and then going into Raging Machine and him being able to use that outlet, that's where emotions are really supposed to function properly in that way, is that you're supposed to let these things out when it's the time to. Because if you don't, you're doing yourself a disservice. So go ahead.
So it's dealing
in a way
with
that's socially acceptable, at the right? Like a concert, the art is socially acceptable to express those things.
Mm.
Like even in your paintings, for example, if you're a painter, your paintings can look as ugly or as violent as you want them to be.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, so yeah, pretty much like when you deal with something when it's right now, you know, like for example, like, oh man, I was mad for a cool 50 minutes and I figured it out, and you know what, I'm over it, I'm cool, right?
Yeah.
But let's say when you look at someone who, like, the smallest thing fucking triggered them, and they fucking, like, blew up and got, like, mad and threw things around and got in a fight, that person was holding it for a long time.
Yeah.
Or they're just, like, really close people. But for the most part, you know, someone who's, like, sane is, like, they're just holding it for too long, you know? So not keeping things bottled up, right? And I feel like a lot of it is like this, like, mathematics way of looking at it. Like, you know, it's what you add up and what you like let go, right? Like, what you if this is a recipe for destruction, like for anger, and you take it, like, why are you gonna be surprised? You know?
Yeah.
Like, if you know, like, things like these, like, this upset you, why are you gonna be in a room full of it? You know?
Mm-hmm.
So, and also, like, I feel like on some, like, real, like wizard shit, it's when you can be around these things, but they no longer alter you no more. Like, it doesn't faze you no more. You know, because that's when you really get over it, right? Is when it doesn't faze you no more.
Yeah.
So I think it's just like practice, you know, like practice. Like, I used to be that guy that would be getting fucking mad for, like, some dumb shit. And, you know, I could create a different recipe, you know, like,
yep.
You let things out, you know. So freestyling was a form of, like, the homie's talking about therapy, freestyling was a form of that, you know, because you're literally just expressing yourself and unloading, like, that's what, you know, you're dropping rhymes, you're not picking up rhymes, you're dropping rhymes, you know, like, you're letting go of the shit.
Yep.
So, you know, whether it's a sport, whatever the fuck it is, man, like, we are supposed to express, we are supposed to, change. And how do you change is to, you know, you have to let go of the parts that aren't working anymore, that aren't necessary anymore. So it's like, you know, these 10 things piss me off, you know, figure out why they piss you off, and then it no longer controls you anymore. So I think it's, a lot of it is just do the homework, man, do the math, do the knowledge, and once you apply it and have that wisdom, you can't get mad no more, because you're like, you can't go backwards like that. Like, that doesn't get you mad anymore. That doesn't faze you, right? You become an asset now. Like, you're not just someone who's getting mad and trying to show people that, yo, nobody can mess. Well, there's always gonna be somebody bigger than you, you know?
Yeah.
So I think, like, just, I think this trial and error, right? We just go through the shit and we realize, like, am I gonna die right now because I'm mad? Because I'm angry? Because I have something to prove? So the same way love requires you to put your pride aside.
Yeah.
You know, you're learning how to battle hate. You don't battle hate through hate. So they both teach you. They both, like, intertwine, and you have to. You're gonna figure it out. You know.
Yeah.
So it's like, do you love these feelings, and if you don't love them, then change them. You know. I don't like being mad all the time. My brother.
Yeah.
Now I only get like that when I need to. You know, but when do you really need to? You know.
You know.
That's how you think about it.
Yeah. Once again, you on that with that, brother, for sure. It's very important to know how to properly use your emotions and be able to identify these things. But now, again, yes, pride to the side, yes. Just like we ended up doing with love, I want to speak on what are some pros and what are some cons to hate or hating something. When I think of, you're like, some pros, something that's positive to hating.
Or like hating injustice. Unfair.
So
right?
flipping the coin
or
on
hate
that.
The machine.
Yeah. It's like
race against the machine is actually a really good example, right? Because he was able to drop all of that rage and hate and frustration into his public art, that gave him the space for more love in his private life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
As well as, go ahead.
You only fully understand and get to experience one when you've done to the other. You know, like, you will never know, like love until, like, you understood hate. You know. Dark and that light.
Okay.
Like, imagine, like, you know, they say,
It's a polarity. Like,
love hurts, you know, like, because someone you don't love can't hurt you, right? It's those you love that hurt you because you love them. You know, you care, so they hurt, they're able to hurt you. So, you know, like, you see the movies, right? Like someone that you used to love, like, now you hate.
Yeah.
Right? And then it's one of those things, man, like, you really must have loved them if you hate them that bad. You know what I mean?
So, because y'all both touching on it, and that's where I wanted to get with both of them together. But before I touch on that, I wanted to add, too, another pro to hate in particular is, and this is for the other person. This is not for the person that is doing the hate, but the person who's receiving it. And I think you already spoke on that, brother, is being able to identify what that looks like. So identifying what that hate is and knowing how to get over that type of hate. So that's another least pro when it comes to seeing hate or seeing that particular, you know, now you know what that looks like. Now, getting to y'all's point, which that's why I came up with this whole thing with love and hate, and it's used so much, we can think so much about love and so much about hate. Now my question to y'all, because you was already saying it, is then, so is love and hate on the same spectrum, or is on that same line, or is it, are they completely two separate things?
That's a hard one, bro. That's crazy. But then you got to think of this. There's things that you love that you hate. It's the same thing. Like people, right? Like, you love that person. Somebody fucking hates them. It's just, where are you looking at it from? What's your standpoint? What's your position in what you're talking about?
Exactly. Reason why I bring that up is because I know we speak about so many of these binaries, dichotomies, all these other different things within nature. There's a whole thing. There's a whole society and a whole learning around polarity in these difference of these opposites and how they basically, not saying contrast, but they basically connect together. So love and hate being one of those. Just like how you said, brother, say you wouldn't ultimately know what love is if you didn't ultimately know what hate is. So
the same person.
Yeah. So really, at least from my perspective of how I've seen is love and hate is the same thing. The thing that is different about them is that they just vary in degrees. So you're on that line. There's love on one side and there's hate on one side. They're on the same line, but in between that, you have all the different variances of like highly dislike. All of these all come together, but ultimately you wouldn't know one without the other. So at least for me, they're ultimately within that same package.
That line also depends on what kind of, back to like what kind of love, right? If it's especially in terms of the romantic love, like I feel like if it comes more from infatuation or a fear of loneliness, then it's actually more on the hate side than the love side, even though you trick yourself into thinking it's love. In reality, it comes from a more of a self-hate. And then you have the self-hate or the self-doubt, and then the loneliness and desperation, and then you kind of twist it around upside down, and you pretend or you convince yourself that you love somebody, but in reality, you don't actually love that person. You just hate yourself, or you're afraid of loneliness, and then you're filling this hole, right?
Projecting
it. That's why. Why do you think the reason why I have the whole thing like that to be so ambiguous. This is going to be talked about forever, and there will not ever be a succinct answer for any of this. But it's just for us to shed light on these things, because ultimately, go ahead.
I think, okay, so it's definitely something that we have to figure out, right? Like, so you can understand the different forms of love and hate you receive throughout your lifetime.
Yeah.
And know how to dissect them in ways where, okay, this person doesn't really love me. How do I know if it's coming from in a real way or in a fake way?
Yeah.
Now, I think it boils down to, does that person love themselves?
Exactly.
You know, and what kind of life are they living? If you're living a destructive path in life, if you're less, that's where you want. You really love yourself, you know?
Okay.
So if you love yourself, that means you got your shit around to take care of, you know? Or at least you're trying to, or at least like, you're making the effort and it's noticeable for you. You know, like how can you love yourself but poison yourself? You know, like it's like that. Like, you know, those things become evident. Like,
yeah,
it's obviously not coming from someone who's being serious because like, they love me, but then they live this lifestyle. You know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's why sometimes when I'm with somebody, you know, I feel like I'm just a stand-in for their loneliness, where they don't actually want me; they just want someone. They want anyone. And I'm just there, like I'm like a statue, like I'm anybody could have filled that role, you know? So I'm just a little drop
in their bucket,
the hole in their heart, in their bucket, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
And it goes back to what you said earlier, right? About the superiority complex, sometimes the hate can sometimes ironically can be an overcompensation for an inferiority complex, right? Where they escalate and then they overcompensate.
Yeah.
And I think there is a phrase to describe that across all cultures, like across many cultures.
Yeah.
Like in native indigenous culture, the phrase is called the wet pico. And then in Chinese culture, it's called the hungry ghost phenomenon. And in my culture, in Burmese Buddhism, there's a word called tanna, which is like a grasping kind of love. It's a grasping feeling that comes from that emptiness.
Emptiness, yeah. I was about to say emptiness, yeah. Yep.
Yeah. And that's why we see hope and fear as two sides of the same coin.
Yeah.
Because when you hope for something, you fear it will not happen, right? So it comes from that grasping thing. And it's a bottomless pit. Like you will never like be fulfilled from coming from that place of like grasping. You know, that's why the word is called tanna, which the direct translation is lust, but it's a little deeper than that. You know.
Yes.
In one of my poems, I described it as trying to reach for a shore that's never there. That's what it feels like, and that's why you have to work on feeling whole, feeling complete inside you. And of course, it's always a work in progress, but ideally, if both partners in a couple or even a friendship are working on themselves to always strive for being whole rather than strive for a partner,
yes,
I think that would be like the ideal relationship or even friendship, you know?
Beautiful. Look, y'all are killing it right now, and it's like we're seeping in. You do one more. Go ahead.
Perfect example. And this is kind of like just grabbing from what you guys were saying, right? Anakin Skywalker, right? Think about him when he before he becomes Darth Vader. Think about what he was doing and why he was doing it. One can argue, well, he was doing it for the love. You know, he became evil, hateful, whatever, but he was doing it for the love but not for the love of himself, and not for the, he was doing it for the love of his girl, right? He wanted to bring her back to the dead.
To prove himself, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know what I'm trying to say? So, he was doing it for love to for her, but like everybody around him was like, yo, this guy, he introduced us to the dark side, he doesn't have love, but he's just he's a monster, right? And then Obi-Wan to talk with him, but really, like, you know, they're just different perspectives, man. You know, crazy.
Yeah, that's why it will forever be talked about.
Because my love for this and your love for that makes us enemies. It's like. So then is that conversation where is love, can love be bad? You know, can hate be good? It's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimately, it's how things turn out and how you feel about it, right?
Personal perspective, all of that stuff, all comes into that. And Shoot. But with that, y'all, because we can keep going in and out on this, but I was seeing that Kundan was almost dipping into the next one, so we're going to get into the last topic for tonight. I appreciate y'all rocking with me, taking y'all time. I much appreciate, and I love y'all for that. The last topic that we're going to get into, and this is all rooted together with this, last topic is conquering doubts. So with us talking about the love and the hate and the whole thing about it's a inside job that's affected sometimes by the outside. Now, how do you go about getting over the doubts that you have, whether that is about whether you loving someone or you may be hating something, or you're just having that breakdown of finding that self-image of yourself? How do you conquer the imposter syndrome?
Don't think about this for a second.
Do it. But as y'all are, when I think of about conquering doubts, again, I'm going to go to it because we got to have at least a foundation of what we're talking about with doubt. I'm going to look up the definition, and then we're going to go from there with it and see what we can get. And if something comes up, feel free to jump in. Right. I'm going to do two of them, for one from Webster's and another one from a free dictionary. So we got the word doubt. It's a verb. So a lot of this actions, we didn't even think. It'll be a noun in these words, verbs having actions. But doubt is to call into question the truth of. Two, to lack confidence in. Four, to consider unlikely. Fear, to be uncertain. And now that's from the Webster's Dictionary. Now from the Free Dictionary. Doubt, to be undecided or skeptical about. To tend to disbelieve, distrust. To regard as unlikely. And then the archaic definition of doubt. Archaic basically means the old definition, not in use. To suspect, fear. Which they also have a state of being, but I'm not going to go to more of those. But those are a few definitions for doubt. Mm-hmm. Now,
it's funny because those definitions make doubt sound pretty neutral or even a good thing. Because it's good to be skeptical or to be uncertain, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what I'm seeing, at least with the definitions here, and we can go more into when we're speaking about conquering doubts and what they really are, we see how the definitions are set up. Like you said, they're very neutral, because when you think about it, that's one way to help with you conquering doubts, is to be able to normalize that you're not the only one that have these. Mm-hmm. That you're not the only one that might normally have thoughts where you're trying to figure things out. You suspect something may not be going the way that you want it to go, or happening the way that you're supposed to have it happening. So that's why at least wanted to set that ground of it, is showing you that these definitions that are sharing with it here, they're very neutral. Now,
yeah, like from the definitions, it sounds like if you have doubt, you just need more information. That's all. Like,
No doubt. Like Gwen said, finally, no doubt. But when we think about conquering doubts, which one of the definitions put in there, it's very close to and akin to fear. We've already been talking about fear so much with it today, but that's really where a lot of the doubt comes up, is because this false evidence that's appearing real, because you're not too sure. You need more information. And because
you fear
that,
the unknown, or you fear something bad will happen.
Yes.
If you make a mistake because you didn't have all the information.
And then what's the biggest fear
at the time?
Yeah. Right? The unknown.
Yeah.
So right away, like you realize, like, yeah, if I become more knowledgeable in this, but I still have
deluxe.
doubt, but I still have the same fear, you know?
Yes.
And no, because the you know, like, once you realize something, you can never look at it the same way you did before. So your perspective on it changes, obviously. You know, someone that was fearful of, I don't know, about, you know, going out of space, you know, like this NASA, right? You know, they had no idea what it was out there. You know, but imagine, you know, they saw some movies, read some books, and talked to more people about it. And you know what? This seems so scary. I'll try to have a look there, you know? Like that. But I think the conquering doubts, it's pretty much as that. And go for yourself some more. You know, because if you don't, you're pretty much insane, because you have the same doubts, and then you still have the same understanding of what you're doubting.
Yeah. Right?
So go figure it out. Go try something new.
But, all right, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to be the opposite side again. So this is a person saying, well, Wizard Kundan, what if this doubt is a life or death situation for me?
Yeah.
What if I don't figure this out, that it's either I'm alive or I'm going to be going off into this moon? What if, as I was growing up, all of the doubts that I had always pointed towards something that would eventually scar me for life? What if these doubts that I ended up having ended up always coming to fruition to be against me? What would you say to that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it would go back to, you know, that's really more of the self-doubt, right? So, which also comes from fear. And just like the general doubt is you don't have enough information about something, the self-doubt comes from you don't have enough information about yourself. Or you even have misinformation about yourself from all of the false programming that you've been programmed into. Like, you know, if you have a belief like, I'm not good enough, right? More of like a generalized belief that you're just totally a bad person or not good enough, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not like you're not good enough in a specific skill, but just a general thing. You know, so that's when we get into the distinction between, I think, rational doubt and irrational doubt, similar to rational fear and irrational fear,
yes,
right? Where it's just unreasonable self-doubt that you have that doesn't actually, you know, make sense, that's actually detrimental to you, unlike the regular doubt, which is just your brain telling you you just need more information, right? So in this case, that's when you need to look into you know, what are the false beliefs that you believe about yourself. You might have to meditate, journal, maybe even hire a coach or a consultant,
yes,
to help you figure it out, or even a therapist. You know, you might, you might actually need outside help, because you don't, you have that, you have a blind spot around, you can't see around your own blind spot.
Yes.
So you need like a third party to help you figure it out sometimes.
You're already giving us keys on how to conquer it already, and that's what's up. Just like I asked the other ones too, I want to throw that out there too, is, then what are the pros and cons to doubting, and, like, you know, doubting not even oneself, but also doubting, you know, things that you are witnessing and seeing outside of you? What are the pros and cons?
Yeah, the pro would be it protects you from being conned or being manipulated or being defrauded. You know, like in fact, I was actually reading about romance frauds. This poor British guy in Ukraine, when he was a charity worker, he got conned out of $250,000 with this romance fraud. This Ukrainian woman pretended to fall in love with him, and he wanted to marry her, and it was a long story, but in that case, like, maybe, you know, it might have been a good thing if he had the doubt. But he didn't have any doubt. He had no doubt. So sometimes doubt is a pro. It's a good thing, because it's just being skeptical. It's just saying, maybe I need more information, right?
Yes.
Now, that's the pro side. The con side might be as I said earlier, when it starts getting more into the irrational, when you start getting into paranoid territory, and mm-hmm. you know, which can go from like more of the mild side to the very extreme, when people even start having paranoid hallucinations, yeah. right? Like a medical conditioning, like schizophrenia, for example.
Yes.
I almost feel like schizophrenia is like a very extreme form of doubt when you start having these hallucinations, right?
Yes.
So that's what the con, when it starts getting more and more irrational.
Yes.
That's when it becomes a con. Like.
Yes. Nah, you took it right there. What you got?
Yeah, to go off of what Kunin's saying, it's how can we dictate when it's either like or we're intuitive? Like, you know what? I don't know why I have a doubt, but I have a doubt, and I don't feel like this is gonna go right. Or yeah. when it's like, you know, sometimes it's a survival mechanism. Sometimes yeah. there's this fear that, you know, and which is good because it helps you evolve to where we're here now, right? You know, we yeah. are the people that were able to successfully apply fear, right? Yeah. And that's why we're here. And also through love and whatever, you know, the whole polarity around it. But it's just that, you know, because sometimes I do have this doubt where, you know, this information should back everything up, but I just doubt it. And you know what? Yep. It's not even like a personal thing. It's just, you know, something's not clear. And I pull the plug, and then eventually it's like, okay, like, damn, I was right. You know, or sometimes I was just tripping, and I should have done it. Yeah. You know, it's, how do you, yeah, like, where is your doubt coming from, right? Is it a personal thing? Is it, do you have data around it where, like, you know what, this is not going to be successful?
Yeah.
It's just learning where it comes from. Because if you just doubting things to doubt them, and you're tripping, you know?
You're just throwing it out there, and it's missing all over the place. You don't have it on target on what specifically you're doubting or what it is. Yes. Y'all both touched on it, basically, yes, with the pros and the cons of it. Ultimately, with this doubt, you're...
Or even like when the cops stop black people for no reason, that's an irrational doubt.
Oh, yeah.
That's
crazy.
Also based on racist bias, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's that kind of doubt as well. That's also a con. Right?
But see, would that to them, would that be irrational if they're stopping it with the purpose because of the fact that they're racist?
To them, it's rational, right? Yeah.
So again, with the whole thing with our love and hate, and with doubt, it is all dependent on your point of view and perspective on how you're viewing and seeing.
Yeah, so is it a, do cops hate us, or do they really just love their job?
I honestly think it is a combination of both, because I know both of y'all know the history of where the police force came from and what its intended purpose was.
Right?
And literally, if they know, they done the history, so... You know, in getting into policing, this is part of the things that you're getting into. Some folks may come in with the intention that they're going to change the system and the intention that I'm not going to be like the others and this is what I'm going to do. But ultimately, it's a lot of that woven into it, brother, because you think about the history from it. That's why you got Ku Klux Klan members. That's why you got white supremacists and other folks that infiltrate and get into these systems, because if y'all didn't know, you can even Google this. There was, back way when, there's a code, also in the police code, for identifying killing a black person, as well as there was a whole such thing as a Igor hunting license, that you can literally go buy a license to go kill a black person, and you would not go to jail or have any penalty behind it.
Wow.
You can look this stuff up. It's here.
It's also the sundown towns as well, right? If after sunset, any black person can be arrested just for being in town, right?
Word, that's crazy. I was watching a YouTube video. I forgot the guy's name. I'm going to try to get his name right now. I'll thank you. But, what's up, bro? He goes that to anybody that tries to go against and contradict anything he's saying about racial injustices in America. He says this. He's like white people. White people. They cannot they cannot say, they cannot argue that they would have liked to have been black in America. And I was like, damn, you know, I never had heard it that way. And like, you had straight up asked someone, even now, like, would you want, and like, no, a motherfucker, like, really, like, you wouldn't, because, you know, like, so we have this Black Lives Matter movement, right? Because, like, it's as if your life matters less. So someone that's privileged, like, for them to say they would want to be, they don't, you know?
What?
So it was crazy how he put it. I was like, damn, that's a trip, you know? I never had to do that way. And it just goes to show, like, you know, because if really all lives matter, well, yeah, tomorrow I want to wake up as a black person. Nothing's going to change, you know? But, like, nah, this would be a big change. And it's crazy the way he put it. But, I want to share that out. You know, if you guys have any thoughts on that.
Yeah. And from that, brother, there's been experiments that's done. I know there's a white dude who literally ended up going, like, completely, you can say, you know, I don't want to say blackface or whatever, but he did experiment where he literally ended up making himself a particular, you know, from black. And he went out and he still walked around the streets in a way that he was treated just because of the color of his skin. He saw how crazy that's... You can look it up. It's a YouTube thing. I remember seeing this video a long while ago, too. I just don't remember the name. But on top of that brother...
surprise me.
Yeah, on top of that, brother, there's also the whole saying of, you know, you love my culture, but you don't love me. So literally loving hip hop, loving everything that is black, but not
that's crazy. Black,
because of the fact that, dude, there's things like that. They want to have one part of it. You want to have the cake and you also want to eat it too. So it's like, when I had a privilege to be able to enjoy all of the things that this culture brings, but at the same time, don't want to be of the culture. And that's on that flip side of you talking about like wanting to be that. So getting a bit of that experience for a day, be like, oh yeah, man, I done this. All right. And then going right back home to be like, well, now I'm good. I'm not black. I'm either white, whatever other particular place. This is not my experience. I can go and experience that for like 5 hours and I could come back to the suburbs, wherever I am, and I'll be chilling and not have to worry about all the things you go through because, yes, again, it's not my problem. But if I were to have that happen to me and I would want that to be, then yeah, that's, you know, I could make it my problem, but why make my life more difficult than what it already is?
What do you call that?
Honestly,
someone
when it
who's
comes
down
to that,
come and party and kick it, but they ain't down to
double standard, right?
Or it's, later. Sorry.
It's like, it's only okay on a white body. So similar to how, like, black people are fired for, like, the natural hair growing, you know, the way they grow out of their heads.
Yeah.
They're fired or discriminated or whatever. And, you know, a law had to be made in California against that discrimination, you know.
The Crown Act.
And
the continue.
But when a white person, has locks, not only is it okay, it actually raises their status, right?
Yeah.
Similar to how, you know, we all remember, the whole world knows Elvis Presley, right?
Yeah.
Even though
I don't like Elvis Presley.
He stole the moves from black men, and then he stole the song.
B.B. King.
And the singing. And he stole the songs and the singing and all the guitar playing from black women. But nobody remembers the name of the black woman who created rock and roll.
Yeah.
Sister Rosetta Tharpe, right? So again, that goes like this. It's only okay on a white person. Not only is it okay, it actually raises their status when they do it.
Yeah.
And that's essentially the problem with cultural appropriation. Like, it's only okay when it's not on the body of the person of the culture.
It's a whole setup, y'all. Yeah. But with that whole thing on the Crown Act, and then gonna start rounding out this last bit of the convo here. I actually experienced that, and this was right before it was about to approve the Crown Act in California. I applied for a job at Ross. That's why I don't even shop at Ross no more. I say F Ross because of the fact it was during a time where I was struggling and I needed to get something, and I applied there. I went, I had my afro, of course, went in, suit, still, you know, looking the part, and it was nice. It wasn't looking all crazy. At the end of the interview, things all well. It was, like, they'll hire you that day if it was a thing. people, the person who interviewed me was a black woman, and she was just like, yes, we love how you interviewed the this. She was like, the only question I have left for you before, you know, possible hiring is, is there a possibility that you can have your hair down in braids, or can you shave it or cut it in any particular way, you know, so working on the job? And I said, well, I can, but it's not going to be braided 100% of the time, maybe 60% of the time. And her response was, let me talk to the higher-ups and those in the corporate, and I'll get back to you. And before I knew it, but I already knew from there, I already knew that wasn't going to happen. But what made me really, not even hesitant, but really look at it is like, yo, I saw other folks in there with their own natural hair, as well as the black lady that interviewed me. She had long dread hair too, which I was just like, wait, yo, so this is not appropriate, but not disrespect to it. That's appropriate, as well as the other person's hair color I saw with different blues and stuff was appropriate. Like, please make that make sense to me. So that's already new. I'm
make
like,
it makes sense.
So I was just like, that's ridiculous. But with all of that going here, you already were given some, Kundan. We got to speak a little bit on doubts with the pros and cons. Just to round this out, what are then some ways and solutions to conquer your doubt? Because a lot of this having to do with the self and the inner doubt before you can even address the outward doubt from everything else.
Yeah, you hinted at it earlier when, you know, because I think it's a self-awareness too, because when you said from the point of view of the cop, it's rational, right?
Yeah.
I was thinking about how even for the person going through a paranoid delusion or a paranoid hallucination, to them, from their point of view, their delusion is rational, right? Because they don't have the self-awareness that it's not okay.
Yeah.
So I think it has to begin with self-awareness to conquer doubt, that you have to know, you even need to have the self-awareness to even know that something is off.
Yes. Yeah. You got one in there, Wizard?
Actually, I have a question for both of you guys. So what do you think, from your knowledge, has been experienced more in the United States, love or hate?
What's been experienced more in the United States, love or hate?
Like, what is, like, is it truly one more, like, that's stronger than the other? I mean, yeah, right, love, right, you would say. But if really, if you really think of polarity, like, they're pretty much equal to each other in different sides. But like, what do you think has been experienced more? And I think it's just when you think about it, and then you can't help but think that they're equal. That's how I see it. And I see like that is because they're through a lot of hate, through a lot of suffering, there's been a lot of love and a lot of joy as well. And then you think of globally, you think of the whole world. You think, like, you know, like Guru says it best, right? It seems that life is just a constant war between good and evil. Yes. So you think it's, you know, this is what it is, man. You know, we live in this yin and yang, and in this, you know, these things where it's like polar opposites, and it's, you know, night and day, and you know what I mean? Black and, you know, it's like, it's the world is like that. Like, it's, so I think when you become aware to what it is, you end up picking a side, right? Knowing that you're both by nature, by law, by God, by whatever, this is what you are.
Yeah.
And it's just, okay, what are you going to apply with your knowledge now, you know? What are you, and you know what I mean? Like, you realize that, you know what, I'm going to spread love. Because I feel like that's where it's at. You know, that someone could be like, man, you know, fuck the world, I'm going to spread hate. You know, I heard this one rapper have a song, and he says, he's like, I don't do it for the love, I do it for the hate. And I'm like, damn, I never, you know, because you always hear someone like say, I'm doing this for the love, this guy's like, I'm doing it for the love, I do it for the hate. And I don't know if he was being funny or he meant it, you know, like, but it was like, it was interesting because I never heard someone say that. And it got me to thinking, like, you know, a lot of things were done through hate that, you know, it still changed the world to where it is now, you know, and whether you like it or you don't like it, it was good. You know, some people, you know, like, I know this is, it's a touchy subject, but you know, something like Hitler, right? Like, you know, people feel really strongly about bringing up just that conversation. But, you know, think of what he, like, what would have happened if that didn't happen, you know, like, you know, this is, it's crazy how things, like, end up just unraveling things, right? Like, you know, you think of something like the Dark Ages, like the Black Plague, and then, like, the Renaissance coming after that. And then, you think of, like, the Roaring Twenties, and you think, the Depression, and, like, you know, the universe is just cause and effect, right? And I think you just choose, every day you make the first decision of what am I trying to apply, you know? And, effect, there's a cause and effect, you know, what force am I pushing, and Am I cool with what's coming back to me? And I think it's just one of those things, man. You know, it's understanding the responsibility behind every decision you're going to make.
Yeah. I mean, bro, you already answered your own question doing all of that, brother. But yeah. To add on to what you were saying, brother, I agree that there is definitely that balance. But what is portrayed in this particular war, or you can say in the programming, TV, and all you're seeing around, you only end up seeing more of the hate than the love. And what ends up happening with that, which honestly I think is a very powerful thing, is if you are aware, like Kundan was saying, you are aware and you know what is going on, you are able to learn how to transmute that hate and turn that into the love that is needed to rebalance out here into the world. Because I will tell you, that is one of the reasons why I personally took the musical route that I took, is because of the fact that I noticed that I could be talking about being in the club, you know, shooting up and doing all these other different things and doing, like, I could have went that route. That's super easy. But I noticed that there was a necessary balance that was needed. So I was like, you know what? I hear all the terribleness going on right now in this music. Instead of me complaining about it, why don't I do something about it? And for me, I ended up becoming the balance. And that's why I speak more so about all the self-growth and the life and all the other different things. Because I can tap into it. Because I can tap into any of those realms, but I know what is needed at that point in time. So even when you are seeing one that is being put out to you to be more of, which I see a lot more of hate going on right now, but you knowing how to transmute that and turn that into the love, you're rebalancing and pushing that skill back to where it ends up needing to be.
Bro, word is bond, bro. It's crazy because literally talking about that earlier, but in a different in a different way, but it added up to, you know, why do you do the things you do, right? You know, and everybody that is looking at you do the things you do, everybody forms their own opinion of, and not everybody, but some people form an opinion of why you do the things you do, right? Or why aren't you doing this, right? Everybody has their fucking opinions.
Yeah.
Sometimes you explain yourself, sometimes you don't. But it's a trip because for me, like, just realizing all this shit, it really is this sense of responsibility. Like, okay, am I really a fan of this fucking culture? Like, why am I gonna be fucking around and you know, putting up this music out into the world, out into my scene, when, like, I'm not teaching it. It's not doing no justice. You know, you know, that money could have fucking went to somebody else or to something. But I recorded it. I fucking spent all this money, and really, what I put out was just some fucking braggadocio. You know, just me talking shit.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't do that. Like, there was a point where, like, I didn't care, but now it's like, I really care. So it's, let me lace myself up. Let me, you know, everything's been said already, some of the things. Let me find a righteous way to do this. And once I come up with that product, then now let's push it. Because a lot of people are pushing, like, you know, things that are full of distractions. Like, you're becoming a distraction, you know?
Yeah.
Okay, you're getting all these people's attention, but what are you giving them, you know?
Yeah. What are you feeding them? Are you feeding substance? You feeding food that will end up healing the soul, or are you doing the opposite, destruction? But go ahead.
Exactly. That was one of my I would say one of my biggest epiphanies was, you know, because you're doing this rapper shit, you're trying to come up, you're putting, you're paying your dues, and then one day I'm like, wait, am I doing what I think I'm doing? And then it fucking hit me, bro. And it was like, what the fuck am I doing? And then that's when I slowed everything down, bro. You know what? Let me be patient. Let me grow. Like, I'm treating this as a chess fucking game. I'm not trying to rush in and just get fucked up. You know, like, especially in this industry where, you know, like, they refer to the industry being a pimp, right? And your rappers that sell out are prostitutes, right? You got that. You've seen that analogy, right? And it really is like that, man. You know, people, even if you're coming out of love, people will milk that shit. People will drive, bro. Like, that's what happens. They'll milk you, they'll sell you, and eventually you're just nothing. And then that's it for you. You know, your career's over like that. So many people that you don't even know their names anymore because that's how they don't exist no more. Like, they were for a summer and then that's it. So it's scary, but it really is scary, and that's what got me to rethink my whole fucking strategy.
There it is.
Yeah, what I just realized also is, you know, this is why I aim for wholeness, right?
Yeah.
Rather than love.
Yeah.
You know, I don't come from love or hate because, you know, what we can now conclude from this whole conversation is that we need both love and hate. We need both doubt and clarity,
mm-hmm.
or doubt and certainty,
mm-hmm.
right? So I feel like one of the sources of doubt, one of the reasons for doubt is confusion, right?
Yeah.
So one of my favorite sayings is that the opposite of confusion is not clarity.
Mm.
The opposite of confusion is openness.
Mm.
Because when you're confused, you have that narrow tunnel vision where you're limited to one option or two or three options or possibilities, and you start becoming very fearful of making a mistake, right? And then that's when you start feeling doubtful. You feel like, oh, you know, I only have these three options, and, you know, and what if all of them were wrong, right? So you become paralyzed. You don't want to move forward.
Yes.
But what if you open up yourself, you open up your awareness, right?
Yes.
Then you start seeing, oh, there is actually at least four or five or six possibilities now,
mm-hmm.
and maybe even more. So now I have more choices, meaning more probabilities for the right decision.
Yeah.
And that's when you start being on the road to clarity, and from clarity you get into certainty.
Mm.
You transform your doubt to certainty from the openness to the awareness to the clarity, and then finally the certainty, right?
Beautiful. Yes, it really, I do agree with you with the wholeness and putting that all together, because they all come full circle to bring you to where you are and to create, yes, that wholeness. So thank you for that, brother. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say a few other ways that you can conquer doubt. Then I have another poem by the brother artist FMC I want to share. And then lastly, mm-hmm. we're going to do our last rounds of any last words. And then we're going to close out the show, y'all. It's been a long one this time. I think it's about to be the record one, but appreciate everyone. Appreciate y'all. So,
things. I'm going to say real quick, much love. I'm going to bounce.
Much love.
It was cool talking to you guys, man. It was always a pleasure.
Peace and love, brother.
Love.
You already know. All right. So, few ways to help conquering that doubt. First one is that inner self-talk. So being able to tell yourself to either stop or to rethink about your thoughts. Another one is to, like you said earlier with a therapist, being able to talk this out with somebody else so they can provide you another perspective that's outside of yourself.
Yeah.
One of the biggest ones that I see people get into, and this is another way to get out of those doubts, is to get out of getting stuck in the comparison traps. Don't compare your life to this person and that person saying that, you know, my life isn't this and that. So being able to not compare yourself. Another one is to keep a journal so you can definitely write out what you're logically doing each day so then you can see. always look back at your accomplishments of what you've gotten so far, so you can see that there is progress being made. Also putting up informational, or I should say motivational quotes and things. So looking things up that brings you a lot of positivity and motivation to do things. Celebrating each of those small steps whenever you make it towards something. So celebrating that, as well as learning how to practice that self-love, because that is the foundation. So really being able to be compassionate and really love on yourself while you're figuring out yourself. But those are just a few. So let me go ahead, y'all. I got another one from the brother. Again, Artist FMC. The book is called The Life of Poetry. It's really dope. Really great book. Great read. He has three of them.
Cover.
Yes, I'm going to send it to you so you know, brother. You can see where it is and get a look at that. But his one that he has for doubt, and it reads, whenever there is doubt, you are in the physical form of not believing. When you allow your spirit to communicate with your soul, you know what will be, will be.
What will be, curse around, surround.
Exactly. Do you have any last closing thoughts, Kundan, before I go ahead and we wrap up for today's show?
Yeah, I think I agree with all of that. Also, going back to the whole mess, I wrote a poem a few months ago called Breaking Up with the Demonization, Exotic Perfection, False Binary, and I was talking about how to see the both end rather than the false binary.
Yes.
Or the black and white thinking. In my poem, I wrote basically that, you know, I am both brave and terrified, that I'm both strong and weak, and that, you know, I'm both hopeful and hopeless, that I feel beautiful and I feel insecure about how I look, right?
Mm-hmm.
So to really see myself as the entire ocean, and the waves of the ocean.
Yes.
And I think that from that wholeness,
mm-hmm.
we overcome the false binaries. And I think the more we're able to embrace the wholeness, the both end, I think the less room there is for that extreme irrational form of doubt.
Yes.
And then we can transform it into the more the useful kind of doubt where, you know, we're just basically asking for more information, right?
Yes. Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. Thank you for that, Kundan. And thank y'all for y'all's attention and time. Now, here is the wrap-up for today's show. When it comes to current events and all the news that is happening around you, always be mindful and know what is going on so that you can have the proper awareness and the proper plan to not only protect yourself, but protect others and inform others and yourself to be able to be safe and make it. So always make sure that you're up on the word. Two, when it comes to love and hate, it all starts within and it is influenced once from that without. So knowing that love is on this line between hate and knowing that you must know one without the other, striving towards figuring out what that love means to you and what does hate also mean to you in those aspects, and using that energy and those frequencies either to your benefit and hopefully not to your downfall. And then lastly, with conquering doubt, again, all of these are all woven together. The main purpose with this is being able to get to that balance, that center of wholeness. So understanding that all of them play a part into who you are in your experience, and knowing that you're not one or the other. You will experience both periodically throughout time, but understanding that it all creates a balance in this wholeness within yourself and outside of yourself. So, with that, y'all, This has been another episode of What's the Word Wednesday Season 2. This is episode 18. I appreciate y'all so much. I've been your brother, Advis. This has been Kundan. Thank you for those watching and those going to watch later here on Instagram and YouTube. Don't forget to like, comment, share, subscribe. More from your boy is coming. But with that, y'all, peace and one love. We're out.
All right.